It's episode 559 of the Locked On Texas Rangers podcast. On today's episode, I'm going to be breaking down what's the latest with the roster moves in spring training, a little bit about the weekend games, and some positional analysis and predictions on what's going to happen for the Rangers at catcher and third base and what to expect from those new starters this season. All that and more coming up on this episode of Locked On Rangers. Let's get into it.
You are Locked On Rangers, your daily Texas Rangers podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
You are Locked On to the Texas Rangers. I'm your host, Brice Paterik, here, host of the Locked On Texas Rangers podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. In this role for 3 years now, heading into the fourth season, a very fun season, all kinds of great stuff that is coming up. Next week, the Rangers finally start their season. But first, I want to thank you guys so much for making Locked On Rangers your first listen every single day. If you're not already, go ahead and follow me on Twitter at Brice Paterik, follow the show at Locked On Rangers, and subscribe on YouTube where we have passed, I believe, 650 subscribers on YouTube this weekend. We are heading for 700, hopefully by opening day. I don't know if we're going to hit 1,000, but 700 I think we can do with the pace that we have been doing. So thank you guys so much for doing that. There's some interesting stuff that's going on in spring training that is winding down. We've got basically a week-ish plus left and a lot more good stuff coming up this week. We are back to 5 episodes a week. There's a little bit of housekeeping notes and going to be a lot of fun stuff. A lot of fun episodes this week. I'm going to be talking with Grant Schiller, hopefully tonight, to be recorded for you for tomorrow's episode and maybe Wednesday's episode to see how that goes. And a little bit more positional predictions for what's going to happen for these different starters at different positions. I haven't gone to the outfield yet. I've already done the middle infield and first base. I am redoing third base because I said Isaiah Kindoff-Life was going to be a starter, which he was at that point. And a little bit more in-depth on what to expect from Mitch Garver in his first season with the Texas Rangers. Now, there were a few games that happened this weekend. Not a whole lot of interesting stuff because, you know, it is spring training, so there's not a whole lot you can glean there. But we did get to see a little bit of Dane Dunning and some really solid work from him. 2 2/3 innings out of him. Couple of hits that were scattered around, but his fastball command looked excellent. His two-seamer, he was just absolutely knotting guys up. He was getting it for called strikes on the inside against lefty hitters, spinning it right back over to cut up on that inside part of the plate and get some called strikes. A couple of those were a little bit generous calls. He probably could have had a few more calls as well, but he really looked like he was commanding that pitch well. Levi Weaver wrote a little bit in The Athletic about a new pitch that he and John Gray are adding. It's more of a, I forgot exactly how he described it, but it was more of like a sideways slider. Kind of interesting stuff there out of him. You should go check out that article. He gets a little bit more into it, talks a little bit more with the driveline guys who helped do some of the pitch construction with those two guys. It's a new kind of pitch that is sweeping the nation that a couple of guys do. Lance McCullers is the kind of the main one that I think of when they're talking about this pitch, because that is the pitch he throws quite a bit. But they're adding that to their repertoire to try to spice things up a little bit and get something new that opposing hitters haven't seen and give them a little bit of an edge. And Dane Dunning looked really solid in this one. A couple of strikeouts in 2 2/3 innings. Like I said, starters are starting to go a little bit deeper into games. I'm liking to see that. Get them some reps, get them a few pitches thrown out there and you know, feel a little bit more ready for opening day to, you know, start like a normal season to go 5, 6, 7 innings, however many a normal starting outing goes. But there's a little bit of more offense. The Rangers obviously won this game because that's what they do. They win spring training games. They're not in the habit of losing right now. They also mashed a little bit, a couple of hits from Nathaniel Lowe. Another home run from Brad Miller. Another home run, actually the first home run from Ezekiel Duran. Absolutely turned on a pitch, and he looked pretty solid out there. And he has been assigned to minor league camp. I'll get into more of those roster moves that have happened because a couple of them have went down. On the Saturday game, the Rangers lost this one. Very devastating. It's looking like their one loss in Cactus League season is not going to happen. They're going to have at least 2 losses. They lost to the Rockies late from Tinoco. Gave up a couple of runs, a couple of unearned runs in the bottom of the 9th inning. And the Rangers, the bottom of the 8th inning, and the Rangers weren't able to come back and make it up. But another couple of impressive offensive outings. Josh Smith had his second home run of the spring Rex had his first home run of the spring. Jake Mrazek had a home run as well. Nathaniel Lowe had his first double. Willie Calhoun had his third double. Just another good offensive performance. The Rangers kept on hitting. Cole Calhoun had a hit and a strikeout and a walk. The big three. Nothing too impressive. Nothing too noteworthy. Taylor Hearn went 2 2/3 innings and gave it, scattered up a couple of singles and also gave up an earned run and struck out a couple. Kohei Arihara looked just bad. It's looking like his bid to get back up to the big leagues this year is probably not going to happen. This is another not great outing for him. 2 innings, 6 hits, 5 runs. 3 of those were earned and only 1 strikeout also allowed a home run. It has not been a super great spring for the 29-year-old. Didn't have a super great season last year with the Texas Rangers. Only 10 starts, a 6.64 ERA. Also had some health issues. Has a 19.64 ERA in 2 games, 3 2/3 innings in the spring, and just 1 strikeout. So, yeah, it's looking like he's going to start the season at Round Rock. If he does end up playing stateside this year, I wouldn't be surprised if he looked for a move to go back to Japan and pitch a little bit there in his home country, because his dream of sticking in the major leagues is looking like it's not probably going to come true, in at least in this season, unless something, you know, really crazy turns around and changes. But yeah, it's fine. Rangers lost, whatever. And then they had an absolute drubbing of the Diamondbacks on Sunday, a 13-0 win. They only allowed 4 hits from the Diamondbacks, just an all-around bonanza of an outing. Marcus Semien played and he didn't even get a hit, and the Rangers still scored 13 runs. Also, the Cactus League star, the standout star, the future star, current star of the Texas Rangers, Corey Seager, went hitless. Very earth-shattering. A guy who has absolutely crushed it every single game in Cactus League. It doesn't really matter. Dolce Garcia piled in a pair of hits. Just kind of a overall, you know, team effort. Jose Trevino had a 3-hit game, looked really solid at the plate. Also had a couple of doubles in that game. Josh Stowers had a home run, playing a little bit in that one. AJ Alexi went 3 perfect innings, struck out a pair. Really looked solid in that outing. I liked what I've seen from him. I still think that he needs to start the season in AAA, but it was a nice outing for him nonetheless. A perfect inning from Greg Holland, who has a pair of holds in spring training for whatever that's worth. Anyway, more importantly, Brock Burke looked really, really solid. 2 2/3 innings out there for him in relief. Gave up a couple or 3 hits, didn't walk anybody, struck out 4 again, has a perfect 0 ERA in spring training. I don't know that he's going to make that 5th starting spot out of camp. I don't know if the Rangers feel confident enough to give that to him, especially with all they have riding on Spencer Howard. But Brock Burke is a guy who I liked a whole lot to be a number 3 starter before the shoulder injury after a really, really horrible season last year. I kind of wrote him up, but I thought that he might not be with the Rangers any longer. But it's looking like he's proving me very, very wrong about that this spring training. So I think he's definitely a guy to watch. I think he might end up cracking the rotation at some point with the Rangers this season. I just don't know it's going to be to start the season. And there are a couple more roster moves that I want to talk about. Some guys who are no longer at big league camp that I thought might make the big league roster for opening day. But first, I want to talk to you guys about a little something I like to call Bet Online. That's right. This episode is brought to you by Bet Online. After months of playing college basketball has determined the top teams in the Final Four and will determine this year's national champion this coming week. So if anybody in your Final Four is still alive in your bracket, then congrats to you. I still have one. It is Kansas. And it's looking like there might be, if you want to put some money on Coach K, whether he will win or keep his career going or his career will be ended by playing UNC in the Final Four. If you want to put some money on that, betonline.net is the perfect place to go for all of your sports betting needs. Head to the website today or use your mobile device to learn more about the trends in action. BetOnline, where the game starts. Thank you guys so much for making Locked On Rangers your first listen every day. Locked On, it will be prospects host Lindsey Crosby is a prospect encyclopedia. He's going deep on every single farm system, the MLB stars of tomorrow, and it's free and available wherever you get your podcasts. So let's look at who's impressing this spring and a little bit of more of the transactions that have happened lately. As of an hour ago, thankfully the Rangers didn't decide to break this news after I was done recording. They have a bad habit of doing that. But as of today, there have been some roster moves according to John Blake, who is basically the mouthpiece of the Rangers. Kohei Arihara, Nick Tropiano, Brandon Workman, and Yoel Pozo have been assigned to minor league camp. So yeah, like I was literally just saying, Kohei Arihara is definitely not going to make not going to break Major League camp with the Rangers to open the season. The Rangers also optioned Zach Rex down to Round Rock. At that point, there were 47 rosters or players on the active roster right now after the most recent moves of Kohei Arihara, Tropiano, Brandon Workman, and Pozo. There are 43 active players on the active spring training roster. Yesterday, the Rangers optioned Ezekiel Duran to AA Frisco, which is about where I thought he'd start the season. I wasn't sure if they might get aggressive and try and promote him to AAA, but he's going to start the season in AA. I think that's a great start for him. Leody Taveras is also optioned to Round Rock. It has been said multiple times by Chris Woodward that if he's not going to get everyday starting reps, which he wasn't going to, he wasn't going to break camp, didn't have that great spring training, that he was absolutely crushing the ball and looking like he could be an offensively capable, at least average starting offensive major leaguer. He is going to play in AAA, get some reps there, get some more confidence in his bat. And hopefully when he comes up this season, it's not going to be as brutally tough as it was last year in his big league stint. Now, also another couple of guys who have been optioned or have been assigned to minor league camps: Chase Lee, Daniel Robert, Josh Smith, Bubba Thompson, Jesus Tinoco, Davis Wenzel, Matt Watley as well. Now, it immediately makes my Friday positional or roster projection look stupid, but I felt good about Chase Lee. I felt really good about Chase Lee. I stand by that. I might end up moving my pick to something else. I'm going to do that this Friday as well. Talk about another version two with some more information. That's probably going to be the final opening day roster projection that I'm going to do, since it'll be a week from Major League Baseball actually happening. So I feel like doing it literally the day before would be not only dumb, but probably also unnecessary, because, you know, that's just what it is. But Ezekiel Duran being in AA, I think, is a great start to the season. Chase Lee, even though he's not breaking camp with Rangers, I think that he really impressed with what he did in big league spring training. That's why he kept him there a little bit longer than I initially thought he might be before I changed my mind after several outings of his and him looking really good and him looking really good in AA last year. But another guy who really, really impressed was like we talked about a little bit last week, is Josh Smith. Now, I didn't think that he was going to break camp at the big league club, but with what he was doing, it really looked like it might be a thought. And Levi Weaver and some of the other beat writers talked to Woody, and when they asked him if he was forcing the conversation about him maybe making the opening day spring training roster, Woodward raised an eyebrow and said he already has. So Woodward also, this is according to Levi, he said he went on to explain that Smith wasn't likely to break camp with the team, but his performance really made them start to think about it, because the stuff that he was doing in spring training, granted it is spring training, but he was absolutely crushing it with the numbers that he was putting up in 6 games, 13 plate appearances with the big league camp. He was hitting .667, had an on base of .769, and slugging .1444, had a pair of home runs, a double as well. Also stole a base, was caught stealing twice. 3 walks to 0 strikeouts. Yeah, he was playing shortstop, he was playing third, he was playing second. 3 games at short, 2 games at third, 1 game at second base, making some really great hustle and effort plays. He also talked about the likelihood if one of the corner outfield positions became open for a full-time player to step in, that Josh Smith wasn't going to do that because he hadn't had that many reps in his minor league career or even in college of playing a little bit of the outfield. So I think he's going to get a lot more reps in the outfield, as is Ezekiel Duran. I think both those guys are some candidates to transition more from playing shortstop / second base to playing a little bit of the outfield, whether it's center field, whether it's the corner outfield. I think they're going to get chances to play all of those positions. I wouldn't be shocked if Josh Smith started the season in AAA, so that the positional versatility would be, you know, there'd be more positions that are open at AA for Ezekiel Duran, because I think those two guys are two of their top position players, prospects at this point, and they want to get those guys as many reps at as many different positions as possible. And if they're at two different levels, then you're less restricted with where you can start those guys. Also, Justin Foscue is not going to break camp with the major league roster. He has sustained a minor injury. I don't think it should be too serious, but he is out for a little bit. Another guy who impressed a whole lot in spring training was a guy who I didn't talk about nearly enough. It's Bubba Thompson. He absolutely crushed it. He is now back in minor league camp. He played in 7 games, 11 plate appearances, had a slash line of 444, 545, and 1333. That's an 1879 OPS for those of you doing the math at home. 2 home runs, 2 doubles, some aggressive base running, a stolen base, 2 walks to 1 strikeout. The guy looked solid. He played a little bit of center field, 6 games center field, 1 in right field. He is a legit center fielder. Defensively, he's got the tools. He's got the big arm. He's making much better reads in the outfield. I really like this guy. I'm starting to turn my opinion on him, depending on what he does this year. Right now, I don't see him as a long-term starter on a team that is competing for a playoff spot. But if he keeps making this progress and keeps improving his plate discipline, his ability to recognize spin, and just his offense approach in general, which had been kind of chaotic, just a toolsy guy who they were trying to teach how to play baseball. He's looking more like a baseball player than just a raw athlete these days. And that is some really impressive work on his part. It is some big strides he has taken, because he had a long, long way to go. He was very, very raw. But again, guys with that much power, that much speed, those loud of raw tools, they have a longer runway to get the plane to take off, because if they get that plane in the air, the plane is going to turn into a rocket ship, which doesn't really make sense for the metaphor, but you know, I feel like it works. It works well enough. But anyway, those are some of the roster updates. Those are the main important things. I'm going to have to change my projection on the last bullpen spot, because the Viper Chase Lee is not going to break Major League camp to start the season, but that's okay. I feel all right about it. And you know, when I am, you know, wrong about things, I like to, you know, sometimes I like to reward myself with a little bit of a treat. But you know what treat I'm talking about? Yeah, that's right. I'm talking to you guys about Built Bar. This episode is brought to you by Built Bar. We are into March. It is looking like all of my New Year's resolutions are kind of going out the window. But the one that I'm sticking to is eating right. And that is much, much easier with Built Bar. They're the delicious protein bar that tastes like a candy bar. Some of them even taste better than a candy bar. They got a bazillion different flavors. They are delicious, and you can feel good about yourself when you are eating these. All bars covered in 100% chocolate. Yeah, including the marshmallow puffs, which are marshmallow infused with protein. They are covered in chocolate. They are good for you. They are delicious. They have so many different flavors. You can go to built.com. You check out all the different flavors. They're always coming out with new ones. Go to built.com. Use promo code LOCKED15 to get 15% off your order. If you want to go check those out and try it for yourself, use promo code LOCKED15 for 15% off at built.com. Now we've talked about who's impressing and who is doing well. Let's do a little bit of projections, who we want to do well or who's going to do well and how well are they going to do, specifically at third base and catcher. We've talked a lot about Mitch Garver in the past. I haven't talked as much about Andy Ibanez and what to expect from him. At this point, he is going to be pretty much the everyday starter. It looks like it's almost guaranteed. He's not going to have a platoon role with Brad Miller. At third base, he is going to get the chance to hit against righties, against lefties, and he's been making some really, really solid improvements at third base. I talked a little bit, I believe, on Friday's episode, maybe just on Thursday's episode as well, about how Adrian Beltre being at camp has provided him a little bit of know-how of how to be a really, really good defensive third baseman. One of the first things that Beltre said when he was watching Andy Ibanez is he was taking note of how he was in a little bit of a crouch, and when he was in his pre-pitch position at third base. So it adds a little bit of movement, and it makes it less efficient. So instead of him just being, you know, light and bouncy on his toes like Adrian Beltre would often be before the pitch, he would be crouching down. So in order to get to wherever the ball was, he'd have to get up and then move. That takes a whole half second, which when you're playing the hot corner, you need every second you can get, every split second, every little bit helps. And Woodward said, yeah, I know he's doing that, but this is all on you. If you want to go talk to him, maybe it coming from you being who you are will help. He also got some help from Michael Young, a guy who went and made the switch from second base to eventually third base. And Michael Young said that the position change between second and shortstop is pretty different, but it's similar kind of movements. You know, you're in similar type of balls are getting hit to you, except it's just lefties versus righties. But going from second to third base, he said he felt like he was basically in space. It was an incredibly different kind of position. You have to be a lot more aggressive. Second base, you can kind of wait on things to come to you. You don't have to make as split second of decisions. but at the hot corner and also at first base, you got to be really, really quick, really, really aggressive. You got to be willing to, he said, play the ball with one hand, whereas second base, you can wait on it and kind of, you know, gather it with your glove and your hand. But at third base, you got to just pick it. You got to like charge it. You got to one hand grab it. You also got to be willing to go back on balls when you can, where at second base and at shortstop, you have a little bit more leeway there. But Beltre is one of the best defensive third basemen at all time. So him being able to share those tips is really, really helpful. And immediately on Friday, it started paying some dividends with Andy Ibanez making some much quicker reads and some faster plays and having better starting position. Just a couple of those little things. And hearing it not just from your coach, which I'm sure was telling him the right things to do, but hearing it from a legend like Beltre. And I'm sure Beltre was talking to him in his native language of Spanish, which I don't know if Chris Fuber is bilingual, but I would assume he's at least, you know, conversational in Spanish. I feel like that's a thing that most major league managers should have as a special skill. I feel like just being around baseball, most baseball players are at least conversational or baseball conversational in Spanish. And I think that would really, really help having guys that are completely confident speaking in both languages, because there are so many players that this is their native language. Anyway, all this to say, I'm really positive about the developments. I'm really high on the developments that Andy Ibanez has been making. He was a above average defender last year at third base and also at second base. Last year, his outs above average defensively was in the 86th percentile. He's also a lot faster than I gave him credit for. The sprint speed, according to Baseball Savant, he was in the 74th percentile. So he was way up there. His max exit velocity was in the 54th percentile. We always knew he made hard contact, and you'd like to see him get a little bit more home runs. But some of the numbers that Baseball Savant has on him and his projected home runs are much more positive. They said that his actual home runs last year, he had 7 home runs, and his expected home runs were 10. He got robbed a little bit by park factors. They also have this fun little thing on their, they're adding a bunch more things on their website, which is kind of fun. But how many home runs he hit would be home runs in different ballparks. So he hit 7 with the Rangers. And so the most that he would have hit, could have possibly hit, I believe, where we go. There's a couple different parks in LA with the Yankees and the Nationals and the Brewers. All those, if he hit full time in those parks, he would have had 13 home runs last year as opposed to the 7 he had. There were no parks where he would have fewer. So there were basically no wall scrapers, is what they're saying. All his home runs were just kind of were hit very, very well, is what I'm trying to say. So that's really, really interesting. And there was no park where he'd hit fewer than 7 home runs. The only other park where he would actually hit exactly 700 runs is Kansas City, which is not a super duper hitter friendly ballpark. But some of the other data that we got on him is that he hits very, very well against fastballs and against off-speed pitches, but not so much against breaking pitches. And last year he had a 1.8 WAR according to Baseball Reference and a 756 OPS. Now, if he can get somewhere around there, a lot of the projections are having him around there. His projections for this year, according to Baseball Reference, are him hitting in 336 plate appearances with 10 home runs, a 736 OPS, so a slight downturn, but a few more plate appearances, I believe, than he got this year. Yeah, this year he had 272 plate appearances in 2021. He's going to have probably a lot more than 336, especially if he is the full-time third baseman. Now, I'm a little bit worried about those hamstring issues popping up, but if he can have an OPS around 750, I'd like to see it around 800. I'd like to see him make a big increase in the on-base percentage specifically, but he's never been a big walk guy. He's probably not a big walk guy. Just turn more of those doubles into home runs. I think that would also help see how much power he's put on in this spring, how much weight he's put on. He hasn't hit for a lot of power in spring training so far. He doesn't have a home run in all of his spring training outings yet so far, but you know, he could hit one today and make me look wrong like an hour after I put out this episode. Yeah, he has 0 home runs in spring training in 19 plate appearances. He does have 1 double and 1 triple, an OPS of 753, on base of 316 so far in spring training. Only 2 strikeouts and 1 walk. So yeah, he's looked pretty fine. Played almost entirely at third base, a little bit. All 6 of his games have been at third base. not a whole lot of moving around. Also, Davis Wenzel is another guy who did really, really well and played a whole bunch of different positions and is now in the minor league camp. He also had one home run, hit .353, on base of over .420, and slugged over .600, a guy who I really, really liked. But anyway, Andy Ibanez, what I'm expecting from him, I want him to play at least 100 to 120 games, if not, you know, around 150 to be a full starter. But those hamstring issues, I always have some questions about those lingering and coming back. If he can have an OPS over 750, then I will be happy with him being this one-year replacement player. We all know that Josh Young is coming next year, and hopefully he can get some of the same kind of help, same kind of helpful tips from Adrian Beltre and Michael Young. And since he has played at third base for most of his baseballing life when he was not playing shortstop, he won't have the difficulty of switching positions from second base to third base. And he might be able to have a few more of those helpful tips from Adrian Beltre of what it takes to be a Gold Glover. Not that I think he ever will be, but, you know, never say never with that kid. That is one of the hardworking baseball guys that I have seen out there that loves the game so much. But Andy Ibanez really did well last year to earn a spot, one of the few bright spots toward the back half of last year. And I think he should do a solid, solid job this year as the starting third baseman. Now, let's get a little bit more into Mitch Garver. Yeah, he was absolutely crushed at every level. And a lot of these projections for him are not super flattering, though Fangraphs does have the Rangers at 7th in catching WAR. They think they're going to have the 7th best catching tandem group trio of anyone in the major leagues. They are just behind the Rays, which I don't think that is going to be accurate. They're just ahead of the Marlins, who have Jacob Stallings and Peyton Harry. Now, I really do think the Rangers could end up cracking into, well, I think about 6 is probably where they would plateau, because, you know, they have the Phillies with JT Realmuto. The Blue Jays have a couple really good guys in Danny Jansen, Alejandro Kirk. The A's have some really, really solid catching options in Sean Murphy, Stephen Vogt, and now Shane Langeliers. Obviously, you have the White Sox and the Dodgers with Will Smith and Yasmani Grandal. So I don't think they're going to quite crack into the top 5, but they really, really could. It all depends on how Mitch Garver does, but their projections for him really aren't great. I think he's going to be much better than this. They have him at 371 plate appearances with a batting average of .237, on base of .327, and slugging .549. Now, he's been much better than that. They also have him at a 2.3 WAR. Last year, he was much better than that. He had an on base of .358. His career on base, that would be below his career on base, below his career batting average, and I believe also below his career slugging percentage, because his career slash line is .256, .341, and .494, and .835 OPS. They have his OPS, I believe, if my math is correct, that those numbers have his OPS below 800. And I think that would be a really, really poor season for him. I don't think that's going to happen. They are obviously projecting his, you know, natural age curve to start downturning at 31, but that really, I don't really think it's going to happen that much. He doesn't have that many catching miles on his body at the major league level, mainly because of injuries. And they are really must be thinking that the back injury is going to come up and flare up and be a whole lot worse than it is, than it has been. But I really think that if he can get 100 games in, that is a solid, successful season. I think his OPS is probably going to be somewhere around 850. If it even is above 800, like, that is just miles and miles better than anything the Rangers have had at catcher in so long. And that would be a huge offensive upgrade. He talked a little bit about how he, on a radio interview with, I believe, On the Ticket, how he is going to primarily catch. He's not going to spend a whole lot of time at first base or DHing. The Rangers have a primary first baseman. They also have a primary DH, and so he's going to catch as many games as he can. He's just hoping to really stay healthy and provide a lot of thump in the middle of that Rangers order and really provide a lot of defensive value. According to Baseball Savant, we talked a little bit with Grant last week about how he's a good framer, but this really puts a number on it. He was in the 93rd percentile in pitch framing last year, according to Baseball Savant. That is excellent. That is truly excellent. And the rest of his defensive skills, I don't know how good those are. It's hard to judge those by not being able to watch him every single day, but they seem to be fine. So you add a really, really great pitch framer plus one of the loudest bats at catcher in all of baseball, that is going to be a huge, huge upgrade. So the main thing with him, I'm hoping for 100 games. I'm hoping for an OPS over 800 and a whole lot of bombs at the top of that Rangers order or in the three hole, wherever he ends up hitting with Rangers, which I think will probably end up being in the three hole. Just keep him healthy, keep his back healthy, and just enjoy the bombs that Mitch Garver is going to bring. So that's what I think is going to happen with the Rangers at catcher and third base. Also, I'll be back tomorrow to talk with Grant. Thank you guys so much for making Locked On Rangers your first listen every day. On tomorrow's episode, like I said, I'll be talking about Grant, about a few things, including what he saw at big league camp, what he saw from some of the big leaguers, his thoughts on some specific Rangers guys. Also, which Rangers made the MLB Pipeline top 100 overall prospect list. There's a few guys, a lot more on there than I thought there would be. And there's more on there than I think there are in any other top 100. So we're going to have a lot to talk about there. Now make your second listen Locked On MLB. Paul Francis Sullivan, please call him Sully, brings you his unique perspective on Major League's past and present. It's free and available wherever you get your podcasts. So thank you guys so much for listening. And until next time, don't forget to enjoy baseball.